the next one, which will be on November 17th, will be over there in the new Panofsky Auditorium. And it's a much bigger place, so we won't have this registration thing. The next lecture is about dark matter, so tell all your friends. Okay, tonight I'd like to introduce Mike Menitti, who's a staff member at SLAC. I'll tell you a little about his biography in a moment. He'll be talking about molecular movies. There's been a lot of emphasis in this series on molecular movies, and maybe a little too much hype. We had one public lecture that advertised a molecular movie, and it had two frames. But tonight, the real thing. Dr. Menitti has his bachelor's degree from Arizona State University. He then got enthusiastic about chemistry, went for a PhD to Brown and eventually to Princeton, came here a few years ago as a postdoc. Now he's the head of the soft X-ray group at the Linac Coherent Light Source that basically makes this kind of physics possible. So he'll show you our new molecular movie. Mike, please.
Thank you, Michael.
So Hans, do you hear me?
All the way in the back, everyone's good?
Okay, good.
Great, because I normally not need this, but oh, the courage to wear it. I talk loud. But yeah, thank you again, Michael, for introducing me, and the honor is it's really a fantastic honor to be here to share a really unique type of accomplishment that we have at this young facility here at the Linac Coherent Light Source. It's just over the hill. We've only been operating since 2009, and this has been a long talk, and about to produce a molecular movie, having a small actor be filmed, and we finally caught that. And so what we see here is kind of what we're going to be talking about, watching this molecule break apart before our eyes. But a little about me first, to throw into what Michael was talking about before. I was born and raised in Phoenix, Arizona. Went to high school, college out in Arizona. I was always, as my mom would attest to, I got into everything. I was a kind of a tricky little kid to wrangle up, and I'm feeling that pain now because of my two boys, a 10-month-old and a 4.5-year-old, take after me. And it comes in spades. And I tell you a story. Back when I was like young, my family owned a restaurant, and back in the day, I got a salt shaker and some ice. And I found out, I put some salt on this ice, and really cool things happened. The thing got really rock hard, and got really cold. And as a kid, I wanted to, be a good chemist and scale up. And so I put a lot of salt in the ice maker of a restaurant. It did not go over well. It was a little tricky. I got out of it. But even then, even before I really even knew it, I got a little spark to, I liked chemistry. I figured it out. And I made my way to high school. Okay, aged a little bit, got a little bit older, somewhat wiser. And I made my way to Westlake High School in Tempe, and I met this man, Man Boxley. He was the guy who got me into chemistry, why I'm into chemistry today. He was a grizzled Western Pennsylvania man. He was a basketball coach. I did not play basketball, I played baseball. But 4 years earlier that, my sister walked into the room. He knew the Eddies were coming down the line. And so my mom made a really good baser. Does anyone know what that is? It's tough, that's right. So being an Italian heritage, Boxley growing up in Western Pennsylvania, he had this great comment to me as, nice. Your grade is directly proportional to the amount of success you bring me. And so I brought him a lot of himself. But in the case, he gave me a lot. His class opened my eyes to chemistry. And going to university, I knew I wanted to be a chemist from day one. So I made my way up to Arizona State University by way of a community college, prior to that playing baseball. So I did that throughout. And then at Arizona State, I got connected with a majoring in chemistry, knew I wanted to do this. I got connected with a professor by the name of Tim Steinway, and he got me turned on to lasers and how lasers interact with molecules and produce and probe and look at chemistry. Now, it was a little bit different types of lasers, always pretty cute lasers and all sorts of stuff. And it was eye-opening to see the world of quantum chemistry and the real world meld and come together, all initiated and probed by lasers. Up until last Saturday, I would have said ASU was going to win the Pac-12, but with the slapping at USC, I'm going to leave that be. But after ASU, I made my way over to Brown University, again, kind of a circuitous kind of route to through study books, studying grad school. Got my PhD at Brown University, when a guy named Peter Weber, and we'll talk a little bit more about that tonight, with him in this project that we did making molecular movies. At Brown, I got turned on to the world of bigger and fatter lasers. These things are great. These are called ultra-fast lasers, and we'll talk about ultra-fast science and what they produce. They were great. And so I got to play with the biggest and the fattest lasers around. Taking that knowledge of my PhD, I made my way over to Princeton University, did a postdoc there under Virtual Labs, and I made my way over to SLAC Accelerator National Laboratory here. As Michael said, I'm a staff scientist, chemist by trade, run a soft X-ray group. So if you all come over to SLAC or LC Labs for a tour, our little area that I'm kind of in charge of is the first hutches, one and two, the blue and the gray hutches. If you ever come in, I'll be happy to give you a tour. So what we'll talk about today is kind of like, again, chemistry, and what really interests me when I was getting my PhD and working on my postdoc was looking at the chemistry all around us and how these chemical reactions are important to our everyday lives, and the kind of the chemical reactions that these things undergo makes it very unique to why we're here as a human, and we'll get to that, and why you're looking at me right now, and why you're seeing what I'm presenting. And then the cool thing is the hardware, the newest way to look at chemistry in real time. This is what I'm going to talk about, the Linac Coherent Light Source. It's the biggest, baddest tool around. I said, I really like lasers before, this is the best laser we did. You got pretty much the best one in the world. And then lastly, I have 52, and it's about how we use these fancy Hollywood tricks to capture the smallest actors around. These things are very, very small. We'll go around talking out of wood. But, chemistry and vision, what we see here, as a result of a simple chemical reaction, there's light initiated. So we kind of see around If we see this little light, the sun is all colors, always different types of colors, all from ultraviolet to the to infrared. But we're really going to concentrate on a visible spectrum. You can see me, I can see you. This little chemical reaction with this molecule called retinol is undergoing a structural change. And this structural change, initiated by the absorption of a visible light photon, allows you to see. It switches basically on and off the ability to like fix the molecule here in one state. There's a chemical reaction, or a little small, tiny little structural change of can make you see me and me see you. And this little green laser pointer up there is pointing the way. But we'll talk about a little bit different a different type of reaction, one like this here. And so light is all over the place, a large electromagnetic spectrum across, and only that small tiny little sliver is a small part that we can actually see, the visible light. But when we talk about this very, very important reaction of why, why the human race is where we are right now, is the production of vitamin D. And this again is initiated by the sun. This is how you produce vitamin D in your skin. Without it, we would be goners, because our DNA would not last. And so what happens is, instead of looking at something where the retinal in your eye does a structural change to look at to make you see or not, to turn that switch, there's an energy regime called the ultraviolet. You guys see this on your lotions, the suntan lotions, UVA, UVB, I don't think there's a UVC, but in any case, lotion, that is. There's definitely UVC type light, but that's for a fact. So this reaction under what the vitamin D is produced is a tiny structural change. There's a little bond breaking right here. When the light is shined upon the molecule absorbs light in this region, it pops open. And that reaction right there, that light-driven chemistry, makes a pretty vitamin D. That's why we're here. And so again, but what we to try to study this type of molecule is going to be quite hard. It's pretty big, kind of hard to work with. It really likes light, so you got to keep it dark. But we can kind of just focus in on take all the other stuff that's around that molecule and simplify it a lot and try to make sense of why this molecule undergoes this light-driven reaction. We try to, as far as we know, one wasn't built in a day, but this is the first step in this. So we want to shrink this molecule, shrink the example down, and to look at trying to make sense of it. So if you look at this, so this molecule looks somewhat like this. And the molecule that we see here is cyclohexamine. This is the target molecule that we actually made the molecular movie with. And you know, like any good movie producer, you always want to have a teaser. And so I can find them out. So this is actually what the molecule is doing. When we shine ultraviolet laser light upon it, just like the sun shines light on vitamin D, the vitamin D molecule unravels, and we are able to watch this molecule unravel. This is a series of chemical reactions called electrocyclic chemical reactions. Back in the day, two guys by the name of Woodward and Hoffman were organic chemists. They pioneered a way to a whole slew of different types of chemical reactions governed by how rings either open or close. And so these are two Nobel Prize authors, a very important type of reaction. So now we're actually, instead of using a solvent, we're using some sort of a light to shine upon it and break that bond open and watch the thing unravel. Because it was known when the light was shining upon it, when the molecule was closed, when the light hit it, it knew it opened. But no one knew kind of how it opened. So this is what we're filming, is how it's opening. And so again, my favorite section, I always like gadgets and I like tools and toys and all this stuff. So the way we make molecular movies now, it's the really fun part, the hardware where it gets good. And so to measure these types of the small factors around in a small six carbon member ring, we need a really fast throw of the light, a really bright X-ray source. X-rays are great for measuring molecular structure because their wavelength is much shorter than what we saw in the ultraviolet regime, but they're very tuned to measuring the molecular structure by looking at the electrons and the atoms inside the molecule all at once. So back in 2009, the LINAC Light Source was built. And so here we are, we're sitting basically right about here.